What's up, ladies and gentlemen? Keep your hands on 10 and 2 because we're back on episode 2 of 100 CCs where we have 100 car chats. Today we're going to be talking about Ford Mustangs. Once again, we're still in the affordable performance car range, so we're talking about cars that go fast for under six figures. So with that being said, let's cue the B-roll, I guess. Guys, welcome back to episode 2. Like I said, today is going to be Ford Mustangs. Audio might be a little different today. Video is going to be a little different today. We decided to use the GoPro today as our main film camera as on the inside, and we have a new microphone sitting in the cup holder. So we're going to see how this works out. It's just a little bit of experimentation for now. So today we're going to be basing all the cars once again off the three points of interest: value, comfort, and performance, in that order. So first of all, we have on the lowest range, we have the Ford Mustang Ecoboost. Yep. It's a 2.3-liter V4 engine that runs about 310 horsepower, 320 foot-pound torque. This is a turboed engine. I believe it's a twin scroll turbocharger. So, you know, it's pushing some power. It's 310 horsepower, which is not bad. It's a light vehicle, so, you know, it's not going to be too slow.
Yeah.
But it's, I don't know. Mustangs are Mustangs. So, I'll elaborate more on that one in the value section. So, these cars are worth lower to mid 20,000.
Yeah.
That's the price range that they're going at. Mm-hmm. So what I mean by Mustangs are they're made by Ford, which the interiors are okay. I know some people really like the Ford interiors. I don't personally like them as much. The 2.3-liter engine with turbo, you know, it's a way for fuel economy. It helps with your miles per gallon, so you have to fill up less, rather than the V8 version or even the V6 version. So you have good fuel economy there. You have decent materials, right? It's going to be plastic, mm-hmm. For the most part. So don't expect anything amazing out of them. They're just going to be very plain cars. For lower to mid 20s, I don't know how I feel about the 2.3-liter EcoBoost. On the value side, I don't see it. On that cheap of a range, if you're getting a car for that cheap, if that's your range, you could buy better cars that are more comfortable, that have better more convenience, just general life stuff that's easier. Like even if you went to, you know, staying, if you want to stay within the Ford range, you know, you could, they have Focuses, stuff like that. You can buy Fusions.
Really, very nice Fusions. Around the same specs too. And it's just, you can get so many more amenities within other Ford vehicles at the same price range than you would with that V4 Mustang. Sure, I get it. Like, back to the engine thing, like, you know, you're saying the 310 horsepower. Mustangs are already stupid light. On top of that, the engine that produces that much is also very light. So it'll fly, but I mean, I don't think it's worth it. That small little two-door car is not worth it for that much money.
No, I would not buy that. That's me, right? Again, all right. So the big thing when you're talking about these, the trinity of muscle cars, right? The Challengers, the Camaros, and the Mustangs. Episode 1 was Challengers, and we hit Chargers, and we did a little bit of other stuff, but it was mainly about the Challengers. And today we're Mustangs. Next month it's going to be Camaros. So when you're in that range, there's certain people like certain body styles, and that's something you have to keep, that's going to be on your mind. If you really like the Ford look, the Mustang look, sorry, but you only have that much money to spend, you know, then that's the value for you, right? That's there. That is what the value holds, is that look for you. If you don't care as much, and you just want a nice car for that much money, whether it look, whether, you know, Mustang or not, you could, you have better options that are just better for you. And I don't know if you want to give up that convenience and that comfort for just something that looks nicer on the outside. So, but going on to comfort, again, we talked about the value just for a second. It's plasticky on the inside. The seats are okay, right? They're pretty average seats when you're in that lower tier range. You're not hitting the Recaros or anything like that yet with the nice leather or the nice suede. So, but you're not going to be dying in it. It's not going to be the most comfortable ride in the world compared to your other options. But it's there. And on performance specs, it's 310 horsepower. It's 320 foot-pound torque. There's not much to be said about it. It's not a whole lot of power. The car is lighter, but if you want performance, it's not, you shouldn't be buying a 4-liter EcoBoost, if even if it is turbo, because it's not like a performance turbo, like a professional turbo, sorry. It's there out of the factory, and I don't know much about it, but let's move on. We got the V6s, right? That's a 3.7 liter V6 engine.
Yeah.
Those run how much power?
Those run around, what is it, 300 horsepower, actually. So it's actually lower than the V4s.
So, and with being a bigger engine, it probably going to have a couple of, it's going to be a little shorter on the fuel mileage, probably by a couple miles per gallon. It's not going to be a huge difference, I don't think.
Actually, it still gets really fit here. Like, it gets around 20 miles per gallon.
That's pretty average.
18 to 20.
That's pretty average, though.
Yeah.
Considering when you move up to the V8 engines. But, you don't, okay, so value. Those are upper 20s, lower 30s, in that range. I still don't see a value there compared to other cars. $30,000 can get you a whole lot of car on another brand, or even just in another model for Ford. So I don't really know if I would recommend that, value-wise, comfort-wise, or performance-wise, especially if it gets less than the 2.3-liter EcoBoost, because that's cheaper, too.
It's cheaper.
So then that becomes a better value in reference to the V6.
I see why they're replacing the V6, though.
Yeah, it makes a little bit of sense. They're replacing the V6s in the next couple of years, so I think they might actually be doing it with the 2018s.
And the same thing comes with the V6. It's like the same cloth seats, same plasticky feel on the inside, the same Ford interior, or same Mustang interior.
Yeah, so, I mean, there's not really a lot to say about the V6s. It's not worth it, to me. I would not say, when you're looking for a Mustang or an affordable performance car, I would not call that good value. I would not say it's a... Sorry, I'm trying to merge. I would not recommend it in any way, for any reason, when you could get the cheaper 4-liter. I mean, not 4-liter, 4-cylinder. So, real quick, though, that being said, we're at our destination. We'll cut back to when we finish. So, just see you in the next break. Alright, we're back. So, we left off on the V6s, right?
Yeah, we're talking about the V6s, and then...
And so now let's move on to the V8s. So we have the GTs, and we have the 5.0 GTs. They run a 5.0 liter V8 engine.
Yeah.
Pretty self-explanatory.
Very.
They run how much horsepower?
They are running 425.
425 horsepower. All right, so that's pretty good. We're in a 6.4 liter Challenger, as you know, if you've seen episode 1. It runs 485 horsepower. So let's do a bit of a comparison. As we are, we've already talked about the interiors of the Fords, and if you watch episode one, you've already heard about the interiors of the Challengers. So let's do a little comparison. How much are the 5.0 GTs, since this is a 6.4 liter?
The starting price is $33,000.
$33,000 starting price of that. This is a starting price of $43,000. So $10,000 difference for a 60 horsepower difference, a very similar difference in torque, and an upgraded interior on the Challenger. What I mean by upgraded interior is, with this, you have the Napa leather and Alcantara suede. So that's not to say we don't have plastic, right?
No.
Switches are all plastic. This is all plastic here. Mm-hmm. The dashboard's a bit of like a plasticky, foamy, rubbery material that I don't know how to explain. But on the door sills here, we have really nice soft leather. The sides of the chairs all right here, nice, really sturdy leather. The suede in the seats is really soft, really comfortable, and it just feels nice to be in here. While the Fords, with the GTs, you have a bit of an upgraded interior. You start getting the proper leather seats. Do they come with suede options in those?
They actually, yes, they do. They come with suede, and then you can upgrade to their Recaro seats, their interior, their car interiors.
All right, so Recaro is, you know, if you know enough about the car industry, they're a, you know, they're a performance brand, they're a racing brand, so they make good seats. They hold you well. These are more of comfort seats. These are like long distance. You sit on them and you feel nice in them. The Recaros are good for you know, track stuff like that, and you know, they feel nice too, but they're not as good on endurance wise. So let's see, a $10,000 value difference. Now keep in mind, these are base prices, so there's a bit of a difference in the fact that how should I put it? The difference in the $10,000 at a base price, you get cloth seats in these. The steering wheels are all the same. The materials on the sides, instead of the leather on the side, you get plastic on the side completely if you are in the cheaper Challenger model, the base scat packs. You don't get the 8.4 connect system. You get an 8.2 system, which is a little cheaper. It's a very similar navigation to everything, but the screen's slightly smaller and the dash is slightly less interesting. That base price is also including manual transmission. So would the Mustangs be? The Mustangs have the cloth seats starting out too. So that $10,000 difference at a base is going in favor of the Mustang. If, and this is a very strong if you don't care about the navigation in the center. If you do care about that, if you do care about the entertainment system, everything in here, I should, you know, like music and controls or whatever, the Challenger has it hands down. Mm-hmm. Because the Mustangs have a small little screen that you could barely do anything with. Because they're very performance-oriented cars, and the interiors aren't as luxury, is the best way I could explain it.
Luxurious.
Yeah, luxurious. But that being said, it comes down to what you want more. Do you want that kind of like a grand touring, long distance cross country car that you can fit your family in nicely and move on to wherever you need to go and not have much of trouble? Or do you want a car just for yourself, just to throw around in the streets, on the tracks? Please be careful when you do that. But just for you. And if that's the case, I think the Mustang's a good value. When we're talking about value, just with the Mustang, I think that range is a very good range. That is like the pinnacle of proper value. Because it's good power. Remember, these cars are very light. And with that much power, you know, it's 60 horsepower less, but it's, what, like a couple hundred pounds lighter?
Yeah.
So put in the navigation. Sorry. For Super Junior.
Yeah.
But, so you got speed there. You have nothing, you don't have a bunch of extra stuff you have to fiddle around with. And, I mean, it's a good value. I'd say that value is hitting a very good spectrum. It's a very good balance. Now, I guess we've touched a bit on value, we touched a bit on performance, we've touched on comfort. Let's move on to 350s then.
The big boys, the bad
boys. Those are the bad boys, the 350s and the 350Rs. They both have the same 5.2 liter V8 engine hitting slightly over 500 horsepower, right?
They're, 526
horsepower. 526
horsepower, yeah.
Which is more than the Scat Pack, but the price on those are in the 50s, aren't they?
They start at 47,000.
47,000. So, $47,000, 526 horsepower for 5.2 liter V8 engine. These are high-end seats in here. You have top-of-the-line everything from Ford in there.
Yeah.
Mostly. There's some extra bits and pieces you could add, engine block heaters.
Just little appearance things or like...
A little bit of appearance
things. The weird lug nuts, the car covers, just the random stuff.
Stuff like that.
Regular car dealership stuff.
But the high-end seats are there. The
big engine's there.
The big engine's there.
The suspension, the exhaust. So
everything's there that you would expect for paying that kind of money. So let's talk about value then. And we're going to, once again, compare it to the Challengers. $47,000 base price. That is the same base price as the SRT, the 2016 SRT 392.
Yes.
Now, obviously, they're not going to sell for that base price because of different options, dealer markup, stuff like that.
Yeah.
But, so 485 horsepower versus 526 horsepower. The Mustang has it there. 8.4-inch Uconnect system made by Sprint versus Ford's little screen. Challenger has it there. Let's see. Seats. That's going to be a toss-up. Do you want performance bucket seats or do you want Grand Touring super soft cushy seats? That is your decision. So, you know, right now it's like a 2-2, right?
Yeah.
They're tied right now on value. Then gas mileage. It's probably going to be very similar because you're probably going to all drive both of them same. However, having a smaller V8 means you're possibly going to get better gas mileage by a couple miles per gallon if you baby it. But that's not to say you're going to get 25.
You'll actually get 14.
What's the mileage on 350s? I don't know much about the 350.
14 City 21 Highway. That's what they market.
14 City 21 Highway. All right, then. SRT 392, 6.4 liter V8 engine. 18 City 20 Highway. But smaller engine typically means better mileage. This is a little confusing for me because I don't really focus on that much, so I'm not really sure how to make of it. What do you think? Since you are like economy cars, everything, what do you think? What would you pick as the winner for gas mileage?
I'd have to go with the Challenger.
The Challenger?
Sure. They're very similar when it comes to the engine specs and everything, but economy-wise, the Challenger has a beat because there's no way, like, you can actively get that gas mileage that low on a Challenger. Obviously, you probably could if you just hit it hard enough, but, like, just generally just driving around, you could get better gas mileage out of the Challenger than you would on the Mustang.
Let's do a little check, then. While I slowly pull into this parking lot, I am currently getting 18.4. And this is on a full tank, driving purely in the city. We haven't hit the highway once since this full tank.
This is in full stops, red lights.
So 18.
Accelerate here and there, but.
So then, that means we're putting it to the Challenger.
Yeah, I had to put on the Challenger.
The Challenger is up 3-1. I mean 3-2. Sorry, 3-2. Then what else could we do a comparison? Are we gonna give it to the Challenger in value, or do we have one more aspect that we could look at real quick?
I think overall in value, think Challenger probably has a beat. Because even though they're both two-door cars, right?
Mm-hmm.
The Challenger can fit actual people in the back.
That is true. The Challenger does have more rear seat room and more trunk space.
Well, a lot of trunk space. The Mustang barely has any trunk space. The back seat's terribly tiny. Okay. Unless you want children back there. I'd have to say, overall, the 392 is probably a better choice over the 350. Unless you just solely want that all-performance aspect of it. Like, you want that lightness, the power, just, and just the little... the difference, you know? Because most... everywhere you see 500s, you never see a 350.
Yeah. So, if that's the case, then, value, you're falling out of it with the 350s. That means we're on a kind of a unanimous where the 5.0 GT is the sweet spot of value for the Mustangs.
Mm-hmm.
350s, I would say, is an enthusiast car. If you have that kind of money and you really want that Mustang look, that aggressive, yeah, aggressive Mustang look, that is what the car you should. That is the car you should get. Unless you want a 350R,
nah.
But that's up there. The R's are 60,000.
They start at 62,000. And the only couple of differences is like the R package.
It has
the wing, has the skirts.
It is a appearance package.
Basically,
it's an appearance package that makes it very mean. I think tires are slightly bigger.
I'm not quite sure about that.
I'm not either, but I do know the R is very, very much so an appearance difference, because it's the same engine. So, if that being said, the R is really off the value range. Comfort wise, it's okay. Again, these are performance seats, so you're not going to have good cross country on that.
You have amazing track.
You'll have amazing track feel, but
track days, yeah.
But I don't know. I think the value falls out on those, and that it would. I would have to list that purely as an enthusiast car in those and that range. So I mean, and then we have, you know, it's a new year. New models are going to start coming out. We're still waiting on the GT500, which, you know, yeah, at this point, everyone's saying it's going to happen.
It's, yeah.
Whether Ford agrees to it or not, it's basically going to happen, probably. So, we'll see how the year goes. We might update later on, but for now, I think if you're going to buy a Mustang, stick to the 5.0 GT. If you want something meaner, use that extra cash to make it your own. Do what you do with it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's from roughly $40,000 to $47,000. You know, that $7,000 difference can do a lot.
Mm-hmm.
If you know how to work your way around and do your research. So, any last things?
No, I think we're good here.
All right, guys. So, thank you very much for watching episode 2. We hope you watched episode 1 before this. Episode 3 will be coming out in March 1st. That'll be about the Chevrolet Camaros, and then we'll keep moving on from there. So until then, thank you very much for watching, and we'll see you guys later. Drive safe.